To go. Hello everyone again. Today is the 13th week of our course. It's the last week of the year 2020, right? Everybody anxious about the finishing of this year, right? Everyone wants this 2020 to finish sooner better than later, of course. So there you are. Today is the December 28th. So we have about three, four days only left in this year. And on Friday, we are in 2021. Very nice. So let's just jump to our presentation. Okay, we were talking about the viruses, the virus life cycle from last week. This is the slide that we left off last week. Here we are seeing the phases of viral replication. But before that, let me just rewind backwards and then see what else we covered last week. We talked about the capsid and capsomere structures of the virus particles, which is virion. Also, there is a definition of virion, right? What was the definition of virion? Virion is the virus particle that is outside the host cell, correct? So, can we be sure that a virion is able to infect, is able to cause an infection? No, we may not be sure about that. Well, probably it will make a disease once it enters into the host cell, but until it enters and causes that infection or the disease, we cannot technically call a virion a virus. Okay, virus is the general term. So virus means it's like a living or non-living creature. Okay, it can be found outside the cells, outside the host cell, as like a non-living object. But when it enters the host cell, it can cause replication and it can cause disease, infection. There, the whole story is called a virus. Okay, just like this. Also, this coronavirus case today, because we know that coronavirus outside in the air, it is non-living, but it can cause infection. So it's a complete cycle. Then we call it a virus. Okay, and there are different classes of viruses, of course. Depending on the host type that the virus is infecting, we are calling them different names, like bacterial viruses. Specifically, we call them bacteriophages, animal viruses, plant viruses. Also, you can call some of them human viruses, right? They get different names. Okay, we talked about the virus structure, and now let's talk about the viral replication. Okay, a viral replication has different phases, okay, different stages, yani farklı kategorileri, fazları var. So the first phase that we need to talk about is the attachment. Or the other word it calls adsorption. However, look at this. This is a D, okay? It's not a B. So absorption is something else. Adsorption is something else. Adsorption is like tutunma, like holding on to something, right? Attachment, exactly. So attachment of the virus to a susceptible host cell. Susceptible means vulnerable. Well, what is vulnerable? Let me try to write that also. Vulnerable. Okay. Böyle Türkçe yine vulnerable diye yazılıyor. Ne demek vulnerable? Savunmasız. Okay. Susceptible also. Attachment of the virus to a susceptible host cell. And the second phase is the entry, or in other words, we call it penetration. Yani giriş. Okay. Entry of the virion, which is that particle outside the cell, or its nucleic acid only. Remember, sometimes viruses enter as a whole into the host cell, or sometimes they only send their nucleic acid into the cells. The third stage is the synthesis of the virus nucleic acid and proteins by cell metabolism, by the host cell metabolism. However, is redirected by virus. Okay, because the host cell metabolism now does not work. It is completely obeying to the virus. Okay, yani ne derler Türkçe buna? Tam olarak virüse biat ederler. Virüs ne derse onu yapar hücrenin metabolizması. And the next stage is the assembly. Assembly of the capsids and the packaging of viral genomes into new virions, right? Into new virions. This is called maturation. Yani olgunlaşma dediğimiz stage. So after producing enough nucleic acids and the viral proteins, now we are assembling them together. So we are making new baby viruses here. Making capsids with the proteins and package those viral genomes into those capsids. Let me get the laser because it's easier visible. And the last stage, of course, everything is ready. So we can release the mature virions from the host cell into the environment. This is the entire stages, entire list of stages of the viral replication. Here it is in like in a diagrammatic scheme. This is the host cell. And here is our virus, or we can call it virion. And there is a genetic material, DNA. So in this kind of picture that we are in, this is the adsorption, the attachment, and then the penetration, which is entry. Only the viral DNA enters the cell. Then what happens here? The viral DNA is replicating itself. If you notice, there are like five of them now. Of course, there might be more. And these little yellow balls here, these are the viral proteins. Those proteins, these yellow proteins, will make up these capsid structure eventually at the end when they come together. This synthesis of the materials, and then here this is the arrow. Then the assembly. So we are making new virus particles. Tabi burada now bir tanesi gariban kalmış, ona protein kalmamış herhalde. We are making new virus particles, and then the release of the viral new virions or the new baby viruses into the environment. Here, this is the cell lysis, also by killing the or the lysing the cell. If you look at this again, we have virus life cycle. Virus replication is typically characterized by a one-step growth curve. Okay, one-step growth curve. Yani tek basamaklı bir büyüme eğrisiyle tarif ediliyor büyüme, virüs hayatı, virüs büyümesi. And so what is that step? This is the step. The latent period. Okay, which includes eclipse and maturation. I will talk about the eclipse and maturation. Well, actually, eclipse, if you know the definition of this, eclipse is like this. That means, nasıl tarif ederiz bunu? Sometimes the sun becomes invisible, right? In Turkish, buna biz tutulma diyoruz, değil mi? Nedir mesela? Güneş tutulması. Okay, güneş tutulmasının İngilizce adı eclipse. Aynı ona benzediği için. Nasıl benziyor? Güneş tutulunca ne oluyor? Güneş görülmüyor. Okay? During the eclipse we cannot see the sun, right? So, same thing for the virus life cycle. During the eclipse phase we cannot see the virus or we cannot detect the virus also. Remember all those tests like molecular biological test, which is like a PCR method for example, they do it on the it's like suspected people, and sometimes they say, okay, you are negative, but technically they are positive, but the test is not able to catch the positiveness. So this is what we call eclipse. Yani virüs insanda var ama testlerde negatif sonuç verdiği evre. And then the maturation. So there is another definition here called burst size. Burst size is means the number of virions released after the cell is killed. So if we go back one slide, here, look at here. In this picture, for example, the burst size is 4. Because that means when we kill the cell, or we don't kill it, but actually virus kills it. When the virus kills a cell, there are 4 new viruses are produced. Actually, this number is quite low. 4 is very, very little number. It's not generally correct. Generally, this number is like hundreds of viruses. Okay? Genelde yüzlerce, belki binlerce sayıda olabilen yeni virüsler ortaya salınırlar. Okay, this is called burst size. Yani buna Türkçe patlama boyutu olarak da adlandırabiliriz. Okay, burst, patlama boyutu. This is our one step growth curve. Okay, if you notice, this is the latent period, and then here is the one step. Alright, this is the one step. Let's look at this chart. What is this graph showing us? The relative virus counts plaque forming units. I will talk about the plaque later on. And then here's the time. If you notice, in the beginning, when we add a virus, let's say this is an animal, laboratory animal. Okay, this is like a laboratory animal. We inoculate or inject some certain number of viruses into the lab animal because we are testing it in the lab. So let's say this number is, let me get the pen here. Okay, let's say this number here, okay, this number, let's say it is 100. Okay, so we are adding 100 viruses into the animal. So as soon as we inoculate these viruses into the animal, look at it. In a very short time, this level is zero. Okay, in a very short time, this is the start. Okay, let me just start time. And after a very little time period, the number of viruses go down and they become zero. So it's almost like there is no virus. Yani yemin edebiliriz ya, bu hayvana biz az önce, bir yarım saat önce, bir saat önce virüs yükledik kanda, kan yoluyla, ama şu an virüs yok ortalıkta. İstediğiniz testi yapın. Yani o kadar değil, bazı testler çıkarır da. Çoğu normal testi yapın, virüs sıfır bulunur. Ne kadar süreyle? From this time all the way to this time. See, all this time period, let's call this one a T time. This is called what we call latent period in English. Latent period means that the amount of period that we cannot detect the virus. If we give this as an example with the HIV disease, the AIDS disease, okay, HIV virus, remember, sometimes when people suspect that they might have HIV or the AIDS disease, it doesn't show up immediately. Maybe 1 day, 2 day, 1 week, 2 week, 1 month, if they go and test, they will get negative results. However, after a certain time point, this time, by the way, changes depending on the type of virus or also depending on the level of like the strength of the immune system that you guys have or this animal has. So eventually, after a period of time, the number of virus starts increasing dramatically. Okay, and then it reaches a plateau after that. So what is happening during these times? These are what is happening during those times. Here it is. So as soon as the virus is injected into the people, what does virus do is they find the host cell and they just go inside the cell. Here it is, just like this. See, virus is out here, and as soon as we give the virus, what they do, they attach to a host cell and they either completely go inside the cell or send their genetic material. And this is outside, is just a like an empty protein shell. This is just a protein coat or protein shell, and it doesn't give any positive results probably. And this is the virus inside the cell, and we cannot detect it. Okay? Bunu şöyle düşünüyoruz mesela. Ders bizim okulda diyelim. Dersler kaçta başlıyor? 8.30'da. Saat 8'i 20 geçe okula gelsek, koridorlarda gezsek yüzlerce öğrenci var değil mi? 8'i 20 geçe. Ama saat 8.31'de gelseniz koridorlar bomboş. Tabii ki değil, değil mi? Çok kişi derse girmiyor, takılıyor koridorlarda. Oraya geçelim. Ama herkesin derse girdiği mükemmel bir dünyada koridorlar bomboş. Değil mi? Ama yemin edebiliriz, bu binaya az önce 1000 tane öğrenci girdi. Nereye gitti onlar? Her biri birer sınıfın içinde. Aynı şey, o sınıflar işte hücreler. Biz testi ne yapıyoruz? Kandan örnek alıyoruz. Kan ne? Hücreler arası sıvı. Değil mi? Dolayısıyla kanda hiçbir virüs kalmıyor. Niye? Bütün virüsler hücrelerin içine giriyor çünkü. Dolayısıyla belli bir süre, for a certain period of time, we cannot detect any virus in the blood because there is no virus in the blood actually. All the viruses are inside the cells. So what is happening during those times? The early enzymes of the virus are being activated. So the nucleic acid production inside the host cell is being conducted by the virus. And also protein codes are being formed, are being manufactured by the virus inside the host cell. And eventually, this is all called, by the way, this is called eclipse period. Bu işte güneş tutulması bölümü. Yani virüsün gözlenemediği, tespit edilemediği ilk an. Alright. And then there is the maturation phase come. Maturation means once we after producing the proteins and after producing nucleic acids, what are we doing? We are doing the assembly. So we are putting them together. We are packaging the nucleic acids inside the protein coats, which is the capsid, and we start the making the new baby viruses from this point onwards. And after we make enough number of virus particles, what happens is cells are becoming lysed here after this point on. So when the cells are becoming lysed, the new baby viruses are released into the blood system. Then we can detect the viruses after that. Okay, this is the growth cycle or growth curve, if you want to say. So let's come to culturing, detecting, and counting viruses. Viruses replicate only, let me get the laser again. Viruses replicate only in certain types of cells or in whole organisms, depending on the type of the virus, of course. Bacterial viruses are easiest to grow. Okay, they are easiest to work on also. Why? Because to study with a virus, what do you have to do? You have to give them the host cell, correct? So to study bacteria, what do you have to give to the bacteria? We have to give the bacteria food or like energy source and carbon source, correct? Like we have that nutrient broth or the nutrient agar. We put the bacteria on those, we inoculate the bacteria on these medium, and then bacteria eats and then grows and makes a colony, correct? However, when you are dealing with the viruses, what do you have to give to the viruses to make them increase in numbers? We have to give them the susceptible cell, right? Savunmasız hücre vermemiz gerekiyor virüslere. Türkçe bakalım. Bakteriyi büyütmek için ne vermemiz gerekiyor bakteriye? Ona yiyecek ve enerji kaynağı vermemiz gerekiyor. Peki virüslerin yiyecek ve enerji kaynağı ne? Onların saldırdığı savunmasız hücreler. Her birinin kendine göre konakçı hücresi var. Bakteri virüsü çalışmak için onlara bakteri vermemiz gerekiyor. Hayvan virüsü çalışmak için onlara hayvan hücrelerinden vermemiz gerekiyor. Hatta belki direkt fareyi vermemiz gerekiyor ki virüs farede büyüsün diye. Değil mi? Sonra fare ölecek zaten. So because of the models, because of the easiness, the bacterial viruses are the model system. Just like bacteria is a model organism to study in the laboratory, bacterial viruses is the, again, the model system for all viruses. There are animal viruses also, and also some plant viruses. They can be cultivated in tissue or cell cultures in the laboratory. However, plant viruses typically are the most difficult because these studies often require growth of the whole plant. Imagine now, you are a scientist and you are working with the, let me just write here, you are working with the oak viruses, okay? Siz oak virüsleriyle çalışıyorsunuz. Oak ne? Meşe, meşe ağacı. Meşe ağacı virüsleriyle çalışan bir bilim adamısınız. Düşünelim. Meşe ağacının virüsüyle çalışmak için, meşe ağacının da virüsü vardır tabii ki. Ne yapmamız lazım? Öncelikle bir meşe ağacımızın olması lazım. Peki o yapalım, ne yapalım, nedir yani? Basit. Gidelim birkaç meşe tohumu alalım. Ekelim laboratuvar binasının arkadaki araziye, üniversite. Sonra yaklaşık 50 sene kadar bekleyelim ki meşe ağaçları büyüsün, kocaman olsun diye, değil mi? Tabii bu arada sizin kariyeriniz 50 sene boyunca ne yapacağınız bilmiyorum yani. Kim sorsa ne çalışıyorsun sen? İşte meşe ağacı virüsü çalışıyorum. Şu an ne yapıyor? Meşe ağacı büyütüyor. Kim çalışacak bunu? Büyük ihtimal benim torunum çalışır dersiniz artık, değil mi? Ağaçlar büyüyecek de virüsleri enjekte edeceksiniz de meşe virüsü çalışacaksınız. Ya da siz başlarsanız torununuz cevap sonucu alır. Dolayısıyla anladığınız gibi virüsün saldırdığı ya da konak olarak kullandığı hücre de önemli. Yerinizde olsam kariyer olarak meşe ağacı ya da çınar ağacı virüsleriyle çalışmazdım. Ya Tarım Orman Bakanlığı'ndan izin almanız gerekecek. Türkiye'deki ormanlarda virüs çalışabilir miyim diye, ki o izin size vermeyeceklerdir. Ya da kendi çınar ağacınızı kendiniz yetiştireceksiniz ve çalışacaksınız. Onun yerine gelin kolayını yapalım. Let's work on the bacterial viruses. Because growing bacteria is very easy. In just one day you can grow millions of bacteria. So working with bacterial viruses, that's why are the easiest to grow. Okay. So other definition is something called titer. In Turkish, titre. Actually, you probably know this titer or titration from the chemistry, your chemistry courses. The number of infectious units per volume of lymph fluid. Okay, number of infectious virus units we can call them. Yani belli bir hacimdeki enfekte edebilen virüs ünitesine biz titre adı vermekteyiz. Titer, we call them titer. So we are doing plaque assays to find out the titer of the viruses, okay, in a liquid sample. Plaque assay, you can think of this as like an analogous to the bacterial colony. Imagine, bacteria grow on the petri dish and then they form a bacterial colony. Correct? Here it is. Do I have pen? Yes, I have pen. So this is the petri dish, and you inoculate bacteria, and there inside the petri dish, let's say this is the nutrient agar. Okay. So to grow the bacteria, you inoculate one bacteria here, for example, and after probably one day, your one little bacteria grows and starts forming colony, and that colony gets bigger, and gets bigger if you wait long enough. Okay, so we can see the colony. Same thing with the now, this is the bacteria. What about the virus now? To grow the virus, again, we need a petri dish. In this one, well, first of all, for the bacteria, we need to give to the bacteria food. Correct. However, for the virus, we need to give the virus a bacteria first of all. So that means we need to grow the bacteria. For the bacteria, we need to give food first of all. Okay, in the beginning, we have a nutrient agar again to work with the viruses. So onto this nutrient agar plate, we have to inoculate bacteria. However, putting like one single bacteria, just like this, is not enough. We have to put hundreds of thousands of bacteria. Maybe like, let's call them like 100K bacteria. Okay, 100 bin. 100 bin tane bakteriyi her yere ekmemiz gerekiyor. Bütün petri yüzeyine eşit miktarda. Okay, and then what? And then, okay, let's put them here. Well, it's gonna be crowded in the end, but hopefully you guys will be able to understand what's gonna happen. And then we put these viruses that will eat these bacteria. And for the viruses, I will make them a blue color. Let's put some viruses also in these like three areas. Okay, one of them is here, one of them is here, and one of them is down here. Probably you guys are seeing them, but I will show you again. So and then we inoculate them. After inoculation, next day, okay, next day, what is going to happen? That is, let me just get my red one here. So these bacteria, they will cover the entire surface. Okay, they will cover the entire surface. Tabii bunu yapması biraz zor oluyor. Imagine now, all of them is covered. Because the bacteria is going to form a film layer. Bir film tabakası oluşturacak. On the surface of the petri dish. So what happens to our phage at that time? Remember we had some phages here. Those phages, when they see a bacteria nearby them, they will start killing them. And eventually we will see like some areas inside this plate, where the phage is present. So what is happening actually, phage is attaching the nearby cell and kills that bacteria, and now hundreds of viruses available. So those hundreds of viruses is attacking again the neighboring bacterial cells and kills them. Another layer. So eventually they are also forming a almost like a bacterial colony. We are almost like forming a virus colony here. Okay. However, this virus colony is not called a colony. It is called plaque. Okay. Plaque. Yes. It is called plaque. All right. This is not a colony. This is a colony. This is a plaque. All right. Because it is formed by the phages. That is why we are using the plaque assay here. Okay. This is called a plaque assay. This is analogous to the bacterial colony. One way to measure virus infectivity. Plaques are clear zones that develop on lawns of host cells. Lawn demek böyle hani bahçede yeşil çimenler her yeri kaplar ya. Bakteri havuzunun ya da bakteriyle kaplı bir arazinin üzerinde hiç boşluk olan zonlara plak demekteyiz. Why? Because inside the plaques there are no living bacteria. Because inside the plaques is like a virus pool. Those are virus pool. Yani virüs havuzları diye düşünebilirsiniz. So the lawn can be bacterial or tissue culture, depending on the type of virus that you are dealing with. If you are working with bacterial viruses, your lawn, that the bütün etraf bakteriden oluşması gerekiyor. Eğer insan virüsleri de hayvan virüsleri uğraşıyorsanız, your lawn should be tissue culture or the cell culture, like human cell culture or the animal cell culture. Each plaque results from infection by a single virus particle in the beginning. So at the end, we have more bacteria, of course. Here, this is how we do it. See, we prepare the mixture containing molten top agar bacterial cells and diluted phage suspension in here. Then we put it on the nutrient plate. And then we have, this is called like sandwich agar or two-layer agar or double-layer agar, double agar layer, which is called. There are different names, but they all mean the same thing. Yes, at the end, after the incubation, here is what we see. The darker area are lots of bacterial cells, darker area. And the lighter points here, light points, those are the phage plaques. And this is the real picture, by the way. I wonder if I can get this one larger for you. Here I can do it. Let me just discard this. Okay. Here, probably I can do it this way. You guys are probably seeing this much clearer, correct? If you notice, this area is all like shady. Ya da bu bölüm ya biraz puslu. Agar yüzeyi parlaktır. Tabii yani üzülüyorum şu anda siz. Agar yüzeyi görmediniz çoğunuz ya da hepiniz belki hiçbiriniz. Şu an bu yüzey mat bir halde. Çünkü bu yüzeyin her nokta karesinde, her nokta kare değil mi? Milimetre kare değil mi? Her nokta karesinde bakteriler kaplı. Film şeridi gibi bakteri. Bunu şey diyebilirsiniz mesela kalabalık bir konserdeki insan yığınları gibi. Hepsi tek katlı, yan yana duran bir sürü bakteri de yüzeyi matlaştırıyor. However, in here you can see some clear zones. These are clear zones. Bunlar yuvarlak, hiç bunun gibi mat olmayan, biraz daha şeffafımsı, alttaki agarı görebildiğimiz zonlar. Bunun sebebi de burada zamanında bir tanecik faj vardı ve o faj etraftaki bütün bakterileri parçalıyor, onları lyse ediyor, yok ediyor ve burada şeffaf bir zon oluşturuyor. Bunun içinde milyonlarca, trilyonlarca virüs parçacığı var tam bu havuzda. Bir bakteri olsaydınız şuradaki havuzun içine düşmek asla istemezdiniz. Sizi parça pinçik ederler. Hatta bakteri olsanız bu havuzun kenarındaki olan bakteriler de olmak istemezdiniz. Çünkü sırada siz varsınız. Ölme sırasında. Alright. This is the virus plaques that we can talk about. Or if you are dealing with like animal or the human viruses, this is the tissue culture place. Same thing again. See, this is a petri dish. We are also using special type of petri dishes for the tissue culture or the cell culture. Again, the darker area here, this is a little bit area, it has thousands of millions of cells. These are eukaryotic cells. For example, they might be cancer cells. Okay, if you notice, there's like a nucleus in here a little bit, and this is one cell. Here is another cell. This is another cell. And these are easily visible with the microscope because eukaryotic cells are larger. Remember, prokaryotic cells are difficult to visualize with the light microscope. However, eukaryotic cells are larger, so we can actually see these kind of cells in our laboratory also. And these white areas are the clear zones that they don't have these kind of cells in them. This is like a plastic that we can see the plastic underneath here. Why? Because these are called viral plaques. There are millions of viruses in here. By the way, battery is going down. Let me check how much battery. Oh, my battery is going. Just a second, guys. Let me just put the charge and then come back. Okay, let's check if everything is all right. Oh, 33 olmuş şu anda puan nüfusumuz, güzel. Hocam dişte oluşan plaklar gibi. Aa yok, plak. Onur, dişte oluşan plaklar bakterilerden oluşuyorlar. Ve bakteriler yediğimiz gıdalardaki mesela kalsiyum gibi bazı elementleri üstlerine tutuyorlar ki bir sertlik oluşuyorsun korunma amacıyla. Oradaki plaklar bakteriler, birçok bakteri içeren yapılar, ama faj plakları hiçbir bakteri içermeyen yapılar. Tamamen böyle bir virüs yuvası şeklinde düşünebiliriz. Aynı plaktan bahsetmiyoruz. Okay? Okay, let's go back. All right, this is again the viral plaques in the tissue culture for the eukaryotic cells. And this one is showing us a T4 viruses, T4 bacteriophage actually. T4 is the name of the bacteriophage. This is very famous, one of the famous ones. And if you look at the cytoplasmic membrane and the, this structure, we can understand that this is a bacteria, like bacteria cell wall. This part is cell wall. Tabi bu arada onu da size hatırlatayım. Hücre duvarı yapısı çizildiği zaman arkadaşlar sadece hücre duvarı çizilir. Şu bölüm hücre membranıdır arkadaşlar. Bu da küçük bir hatırlatma olsun size. Anlayanlarınız anlamıştır. So this is the cell wall. This is the cell membrane. So if you look at it, what kind of bacteria is this one? Is this a gram positive or gram negative? Check out the cell wall. We have a peptidoglycan layer here. See peptidoglycan layer. And we have another almost like a similar to the cytoplasmic membrane, which is called outer membrane. So this is a gram negative bacterial wall and bacterial membrane, if you remember. So this one is showing us the T4 phage coming and attaching to the bacterial wall through the tail fibers, these legs, and eventually squeezing or sending its genetic material. This is the green one here, the green genetic material inside, all the way inside to the bacterial cell. Okay, this is their DNA. If you notice, it's like a double helix structure of the DNA here, it's shown. And there is a YouTube video here. Let me just try to check that one, if we can turn it on. That. Okay, let's check that video if it works. All All right, looks like it's gonna work. What is this? Okay, after this, there is a commercial advertisement. Okay, if you notice, it's like a 1 minute video. If you notice, this T4FH is just like a spaceship that we are sending to the moon. See, and this is the E. coli bacteria that you noticed. The one that underneath the background is the big, huge pink one is the E. coli bacteria. And this is the T4FH, the virus particle. See, even look at it. It recognizes the cell and then it binds it. It binds it through the tail fibers, and then the DNA is inside the cell, inside the head structure. Then it will just like try to get the almost like the oil from the underground. So it's going to pump its genetic material inside the cell. Now we are going to see that. Now we are going inside the head structure of the virus, and this is the genetic material that you are seeing, DNA. Then that genetic material is being sent to the cell right here, if you notice. And here is inside the cell. Okay, now the genetic material is inside the bacterial cell. Now, what is it going to do? It will make a lot of baby viruses, then kill the bacteria. Now, hundreds of virus particles are freely available in the environment. They will go and attack the other bacteria now. Okay, ne yapacaklar bu durumda? Gidip diğer bakterilere de saldıracaklardır. All right. Once we look at it, the replication of the bacteriophage T4, this is the name of the bacteriophage, by the way, again. T4 genome can be divided into three parts. Those are named early, middle, and late proteins. So what do we mean early, middle, and late? These are the proteins and the enzymes, okay, enzymes that are activated early, that means in the beginning of infection, middle, in the middle of infection, and late towards the end of the infection. So after the late proteins, of course, the cell, the host cell is going to be killed. Okay, that's why they get these names, early, middle, and late proteins. Early and middle proteins, they are enzymes that are needed for DNA replication and transcription for the virus, okay? However, the late proteins, these are the head and tail proteins of the bacteriophage structure, and also the enzymes that are required, that are needed to liberate mature phage particles. Liberate demek, özgürlüğe ulaştırmak için demek yani. Yani ne? Hücrenin parçalanmasından sorumlu olan enzimler. Yani hücre duvarını eritebilen enzimler. Okay, lyse yapabilen enzimler bunlar. Alright? So here again, this slide is showing that one. See, look at it here, the infection. Okay, infection at the zero time, and this is the minutes. If you look at it in 25 minutes, after the infection starts in a bacteria by the T4 phage, a bacteria left only 25 minutes of life. Imagine, bir virüsle enfekte olduğunuzu düşünün. Okay, gerçi insanız, bakteri değiliz. Hadi bir de bakteri olduğunuzu düşünelim. Virüs sizi enfekte ettiğinde arkadaşlar, 25 dakikalık bir ömrünüz kalıyor yaklaşık bir bakteri olarak. Ki bunun böyle olması lazım. Sebebi zaten biliyoruz ki bakteriler de zaten 15 dakikada, yarım saatte bir kendileri bölünüyorlar. Demek ki virüsün bu bakterinin bölünmesini bloke edip kendini çoğaltarak bakteriyi öldürmesi gerekiyor. Alright, this is what it shows. See, the early proteins, middle proteins and late proteins are activated in these minutes, and then the kills the cell through the lysis, and now new bacteriophages available to infect other cells. All right. So we have here another small video. Let's check that one. This is showing us the viral replication of a virulent bacteriophage. Okay, bacteriophage, again the bacteria infecting viruses. Let's look at it. Okay, the virulent phages, virulent means, by the way, they can cause disease. Yani virulent bacteriophages means it can kill the, or it can infect the bacteriophage. Okay, they have two different life cycles. Bacteriophages, two different life cycles. How are they? One of them is called lytic cycle. Okay, one of them is called lytic cycle. In this one, the bacteria is going to die. And there is another cycle called lysogenic cycle. In that one, bacteria do not die immediately. Okay, here is, let's look at the lytic cell cycle. A bacteriophage attaching to the surface of the bacteria. By the way, this one here is not a nucleus. Okay, this is not the nucleus. Because we know bacteria are prokaryotic organisms. So what is this? This is the circular DNA of the bacteria. Okay, this one is the circular DNA of the bacteria, not the nucleus, guys. So after injection of the bacteriophage DNA, the first job of the DNA is to inactivate the bacterial DNA. Okay, virüs DNA'sının ilk yapacağı iş, bakteri içine girdiğinde bakterinin kendi DNA'sını inaktive etmektir, işlemez hale getirmektir. Bunun için yanında gelen bazı proteinler direkt bakteri DNA'sına saldırır ve onu keserler çeşitli boyutlarda ki artık hiçbir hükmü kalmasın bakterinin içinde diye. So after eliminating this bacterial DNA, now bacteria is completely available for the virus. After that, virus DNA is copying itself using the bacterial machinery, of course. And then it produces the protein structure. Viruses, and then lyse the cell, kill the cell. Now the viruses are freely available in the environment to infect other bacteria. So this stage completely is called lytic cycle. See, phage DNA is now, phage DNA is killing the or inactivating the bacterial DNA. Phage DNA is replicated, and then virus proteins are produced. Now the new baby viruses are available, and then they go freely to infect other bacteria. All right, this is called a lytic cycle. Okay, however, we have other type of viruses as well. Okay, the bacteriophages. Now, if you notice, there are two types of bacteriophages. One of them is virulent bacteriophages, and the other one is temperate bacteriophages. Okay, virulent means they are causing the host cell die. Okay, temperate bacteriophages, they don't kill them, they don't necessarily kill them. So this is a viral life cycle. The virulent mode means viruses lyse host cells, lyse them after the infection. Okay. However, in the temperate mode for the temperate bacteriophages, viruses replicate their genomes. See, look at it. Viruses replicate their genomes. How? In tandem with the host genome. What does in tandem with host genome means? It means with, together with, okay? In tandem with or together with. Together with the host genome, look at, this is the important thing, without killing the host, okay? Without killing the host. So the bacteria is surviving here. So this virus, however, a temperate virus, can go lytic later on. Bunun da garantisi yok. Bir tane temperate faj varsa, konak hücreyi öldürmüyorsa, bu hiç öldürmeyecek anlamına gelmez. Virüsler bir temperate yaşam stiline sahip olup sonradan litiye dönüşebilirler. Litik virüsler temperate'a dönüşebilirler, tekrardan dönüşebilirler. Bunlar devamlı içinde var olan hayat döngüleri. So temperate bacteriophages and lysogeny. Now let's talk about the lysogeny. Temperate viruses, they can undergo a stable genetic relationship within the host. See, a stable genetic relationship. Konak hücreyle genetik bir ilişkiye girebiliyorlar. But they can also kill cells through the lytic cycle. Tabii bu gerekirse ya da ileride lytic döngüye de geçebilirler. Lysogeny is the state, bu bir durumdur, is the state where most virus genes are not expressed. See, most virus genes are not expressed. This is the key word, not expressed. And virus genome, in that case it is called a prophage by the way, is replicated in synchrony with the host, in tandem with host, or together with host chromosome. Lysogen is another definition. Lysogen is a bacterium, okay, which contains a prophage. What is prophage? Prophage is the virus genome. However, when it is not expressed completely, okay. So if a prophage is inside a bacteria, that bacteria is called a lysogen. All right. Under certain conditions, lysogenic viruses may go back to the lytic pathway again, revert, that means go back to the lytic pathway and begin to produce virions again, and of course kill the cell after that. After producing virions, they can kill the cell. And this shows the lytic pathway here, lytic pathway, and this is shows the lysogenic pathway. See, and let me get the laser again here. Entrance of the virus DNA, here's virus DNA. So there are two options for this virus now. It can go, it can do what? It can both inactivate the bacterial DNA, this is the host DNA, burada linear çizmişler ama circular'dır, onu hatırlatalım. It can inactivate the host DNA and then replicate itself, replicate the proteins, make new baby viruses, and then viruses are available, freely available, kill in the cell. This is the lytic pathway. Or it can choose the lysogenic pathway. How is that? So in this one, virus DNA does not inactivate the host DNA. Actually, virus DNA integrates inside the host DNA. Yani viral DNA hücrenin kendi DNA'sının içine girip saklanabiliyor. Orada bir yer buluyor ve kendisi içeri giriyor. Ve in this case, this is called a prophage. Okay? This viral DNA is called prophage. And this bacteria is called a lysogen. So this is the lysogenize edilen bir hücre buradaki. Yani bu bir lisojen. Artık bu bakteri içinde virüs taşıyan bir bakteri. Ama bu bakteri kolay kolay ölmeyecek. Alright? So what's going to do this bacteria? This bacteria, of course this bacteria is going to eat and then grow. And then it will make division like through the binary fission if you remember. And it will produce two new baby bacteria. So these bacteria, each one has the virus DNA inside them, both of them. So some of them may choose to go back to lytic cycle again, and then inactivate the DNA, replicate itself, go back to the lytic cycle, and continue. And some of them continues the lysogenic cycle, maybe for years, for tens of years, for months, who knows how much time. All right. See, there is also another small YouTube video here. Let me just check if we can also turn that one on. So let's look at it. I put this video again for you. Let's see, what is this? Again, this is a small video. See, again, the virus part, bacteriophage, as you can see here. This is the bacteria. And this one is double-stranded helix circular DNA of the bacteria. Now let's look at the infection and what's going to happen. Evet, okay. So the virus bacteriophage is coming, attaching to the cells, and then now it's going to send its back DNA. Now look at this is a virus DNA inside the bacteria, okay, and then look at it. It breaks the bacterial DNA and inserts itself inside the bacterial DNA. See, now this green piece is the provirus, or you can call this prophage also, two names. Now, once we look at the division of the bacterial DNA, the bacteria is going to replicate its own DNA, and then it will give two different bacteria. Now the virus is still inside them. Okay? This is called the lysogenic cycle. So in any time, this phage can go out, this bacterial DNA, go to the lytic cycle, and then broke the bacterial DNA, make new viruses, and then kill the cell, and then go out. Okay? So lytic cycle and lysogenic cycles are two different cycles that the bacteria or the virus can change in between them, depending on. Actually, we have a nice, actually we have the herpes virus, actually is one of these type of viruses. See, we have another lysogenic cycle and lytic cycle video for us here again. These are the temperate bacteriophages. Okay, why? Because they can go into the lysogenic cycle. See, this is the lytic cycle that they can go into. This is the one that we learned already with the virulent phages. Virulent phages, remember, the attachment, infection, and then making new baby viruses, and viruses then released. However, in the temperate phages, they can choose either lysogenic cycle or lytic cycle. Let's now try to see that with this animation. Now, this lytic cycle is what we know. Let me just go a little forward here. The DNA is coming inside. The DNA, the bacterial DNA is broken down. Now, new phages are being made and they are released. So this is completely a lytic cycle. Now, let's look at the lysogenic cycle. In the lysogenic cycle, the change will be right here in this stage. After the infection, now we have the virus DNA and we have here the bacterial DNA. What is going to happen is that this phage DNA will integrate itself into the bacterial DNA. Now the part of the DNA is virus now. And this virus DNA is called a prophage. In the other video, if you notice, it called them provirus. So provirus and prophage are the same thing, okay? Same thing for the bacterial point of view also. So in prophage, what is going to happen now? When the bacteria is growing, the prophage will also be copied, okay? So in any time, through some effects, this prophage can go out and then start eliminating the bacterial DNA, then go into the lytic cycle again. Okay? See, it can go continually living this way. However, in sometimes this prophage again releases itself from the bacterial DNA and kills the bacterial DNA and go into the lytic cycle again. So this is the reality. All right. Where are we here? Geldiğimizi görmek istedim. Okay, we are here. Okay, we are a little bit left here. All right. Bacteriophages are very diverse. Best studied bacteriophages infect enteric bacteria. Examples are E. coli and Salmonella. Most phages contain double-stranded DNA genomes. Most of the bacteriophages are naked, but some of them may possess lipid envelopes. And they are structurally complex, containing heads, tails, and other components. Here's some of the bacterial DNA structures. If you notice, there are some RNA viruses, there are some single-stranded DNA viruses, there are some double-stranded DNA viruses. And they have different names like T3, T7, mu, lambda, T2, and T4. These are some of the best known bacterial viruses. And let's look at the animal viruses. However, in the animal viruses, if you notice, bacterial viruses, they most of them have legs, like almost like a leg structure, these protein structures that can they can use to recognize and attach on the bacterial surfaces, these purple ones. However, in the animal viruses, also these are also the human viruses, they don't have these kind of legs. Entire virus particle or the virion enters the animal cell, unlike the prokaryotes. In bacteriophages, they send their DNA. Animal viruses, the entire virus goes into the cell. There are many more kinds of enveloped animal viruses than the enveloped bacterial viruses. And here are some of their pictures. And this is the superstar of this year, like 2020. Here is it, you see, guys, the coronaviruses. There are other viruses like retroviruses. Retrovirus is the example of the HIV, for example, for the AIDS. Or another one here, hepadnavirus, or sometimes hepadNA virus, but it's called hepadnavirus. Hepadnavirus is the example of the hepatitis disease. Remember those hepatitis, yani hepatit hastalığı, ona sebep olan. Here is the pox virus. Bu ne? Pox neydi? Chicken pox. Çiçek hastalığına sebep olan virüs. Herpes virus. This is another one. This is called the uçuk virüsü. Bizim bahsettiğimiz, hani duymuşsunuzdur. There are different types of viruses also. Okay? Like arena virus, paramyxovirus, bunya virus, orthomyxovirus, toga virus, Rio virus, there are different kind of viruses are also available. All right, I will just stop here for with the animal. We will talk about some like retroviruses, and I also put some information on the COVID-19, the coronavirus, then some interaction, and there like only little bit left over. However, I'm squeezed by time right now. So these four slides I will cover you in the next week, guys. All right. We'll talk about some information on the retroviruses, the HIV, and then the coronaviruses. There is this only four slides left. I hope this was a beneficial lecture for this week. And I will see you guys next week. All right. Bu arada bu yazılar da gayet güzel çalışıyorlar. İyi yani. Tabii şu an ne dediğimi anlamaya çalışıyor. Anlayamazsın, Türkçe bilmiyorsun. All right, guys. So I'm just gonna stop the recording. probably no question, no nothing. Okay, good. Okay, let's stop the